The goal here is right use of time, right use of mind. So we don't want to waste time at all. And with that in mind, I will say this. Since the end of 1969, I have been in a coma. In a coma, actually. I'm trying to awaken from this coma. And I mean this literally, a spiritual coma. A spiritual coma. Why? Because I got nowhere with trying to teach the world as a young person, and the pressure was so strong to say, hey, let's negotiate here. Okay, they said, okay, we see you've got something very important and you want to share with the world. Okay, let's be fair, let's negotiate. So what happens when I finally said, okay, I'm not getting anywhere the way I'm going? The ego says, okay, what, in order to negotiate, first step, good faith. Both sides have to give up what's most precious to them so each one can realize the other has made a commitment to the negotiations. So I said, oh, okay, ego. All right, and the ego says, okay, I'll give up the demand that you be annihilated immediately. and you give up the demand that people accept the vision of oneness, okay. And well, you give up your spiritual awareness, basically, is what the ego said. You give up your spiritual will. Give up your spiritual will. Let's put it that way. So the ego says, I won't annihilate you right away, but you have to give up your spiritual will. And let's meet then on the level of the intellect, on this level of talking about it, negotiations. So when I agreed to that, what happened was I went into a coma, actually. A coma. A coma of seeming like my spiritual will was paralyzed. And it seemed as if I said, wow, how's this happened to me? Well, because I gave it up, actually, in a good faith gesture to negotiate with the ego, thinking that by negotiating with the ego, I could forestall and stop the troubles that were coming in this world, because I knew what the troubles were coming into this world. I knew what was going to happen here. And I felt like I could try and do something to stop it. That was the purpose. Let's stop what's happening. Let's turn things around. And the ego got me, eventually wore me down into negotiations. And I thought, okay, at least, you know, the ego is talking now. Before, it was stonewalling the whole thing. Well, big mistake on my part, of course. Tragic mistake. And I've been paying for it ever since. So for me, what I'm doing is I'm consciously now realizing, hey, I've been in a coma. How long has that been? 44 years. I've been in a coma for 44 years, actually. I've been walking and, you know, everyone thinks, oh, but there's been no spiritual will there. I'm like empty. I felt empty for 44 years, empty. Which is exactly what the ego wanted. Because once I drop my spiritual will, I cannot tell people that the ego is a liar, and I cannot give them enough juice to reassure them that the ego can never negotiate in good faith. It cannot drop its position because it doesn't have free will. It doesn't have any free will. It's not a creation. It's a projection. So the ego can never negotiate in good faith. So there's no point in dropping or even attempting it. And this is what I should have been teaching. This is a depth of understanding that wasn't there previously. It was a depth of understanding. So the way to awaken from a coma, and actually we're all in a severe coma. The more we're aware of it, the closer we are to awakening, right? Because when you're in a real severe coma, you don't even know you're in a coma. If you know you're in a coma, that means you are almost awake. It really does mean that. So what I'm doing is I'm saying, hey, I've been in a coma. I'm waking up from my coma. I'm waking up from my coma right now. This is my awakening from the coma that I've been in. And as you own it, you see, as you own your life and what you did, what happened, you made an agreement that was that you did in good faith, that was actually with the ego, which always makes agreements in bad faith, promises in bad faith. And there, you know, how do you make a promise with nothing? You cannot. How do you make a negotiate with nothing? You can't. The ego is not a free agent. All right, it's a puppet. It's a projection puppet. So if we, the more we accept the fact that we're responsible for our condition, I'm responsible for paralyzing my own will. Okay, even though I did it with good intentions, I still did it. I still did it. And then what happens was, is the ego then immediately claims that it did it to you. So then you feel you have to enter into negotiations with the ego and keep, stay in negotiations, so it will release your will. The ego says, ha ha, you see, I've got your, I trapped your will. Or the ego might say to you, let's make good faith, you give your spiritual will to me so I have that, and I'll give my demand that you die, be annihilated, everyone be annihilated, I'll give that to you, you have that, and then we'll negotiate. But it still feels like the ego has your will, and you have to beg the ego, please give me back my will, ego, I'll do anything for you, just give me back my will. That's the situation. That's the coma, is we're extremely deluded. The way to not die is to recover your spiritual will, to reclaim it, to own it, to re-own it. Actually, that is the way. That is the way to eternal life. That is the realization of eternal life. So I'm starting to realize, I'm starting to return to that state of 1969. I really am. I can feel it. I can feel it. I feel like I'm waking up to that condition prior to trying to give my will away, spiritual will away, to the ego as a good faith gesture, so that the ego would release the hostage. Just, you know, it's like the ego is like holding everyone hostage. At least it seems like that. When I came into the world, I came in because I heard all these people screaming that they were trapped and they were being held hostage. And please, they were, could you please come help me, help us? So they came in and all these people are acting like they're trapped, they're hostage. And so I said, ego, let the hostages go. And the ego says, okay. But let's negotiate, but in good faith, I need to keep your spiritual will, and you keep my demand that I annihilate the hostages, okay? And let's negotiate. It's like that. It's just like that, if not exactly like that. So the fact is that everybody that is trapped, the ego tricked the same way. Tricked the same way, same basic way, that there's some hostage. And they're desperate, please help me, I'm trapped. And, oh my gosh, okay. And the ego says, look, okay, we'll talk about the release of this hostage, but first you have to give me your spiritual will. And then boom, you become the second hostage. And the third one comes, the same thing, over and over and over until you got a whole planet full of hostages. But the key is that nobody's hostage to the ego. Nobody is hostage to the ego. And when you start to realize this, that means you're really going to wake up. And not only will you recover your spiritual will, but you'll be wise as well. You'll be wise to the situation, actually. So that's what we're doing. That's why the cell phone, I turned off my cell phone because it wasn't working, and pulled the battery out, put it back in, turned it on again. The date came up on the cell phone. December 31st, 1969. It was 1969. You see, I took the battery out, cleared it, right? Cleared the malfunctioning cell phone, put the battery back in, 1969. That, you know, that was the time when I finally decided I needed to, you know, negotiate with the ego and make this good faith, even though I knew, I said, this is wrong, there's something wrong about this. I thought I didn't have any option because nobody was, you know, listening. So that was telling me, you're returning to your 1969, pre-1969 state, really. I think 1969, that year, was the year of transitioning into loss of spiritual will, or feeling that it's gone, that the ego has now has it. The ego doesn't have anything. It's a projection. It doesn't actually have anything. It doesn't have our spiritual will. We're not trapped. We're not trapped. Of course, if you don't have your spiritual will, you're going to feel trapped. And I've felt trapped my whole life since I did that. I felt like I can't move. I have no will to move or do anything. That you're just basically stuck in circumstance, right? That's the feeling, that you're stuck in circumstance, even the circumstance of this world, okay? This world, nature, perception. Being stuck is a lot of things, actually. It encompasses the entirety of our experiencing. Stuck in our experiencing, stuck in death, right? Stuck in the body. All this stuff is not true. We're not stuck in anybody. We're not stuck in death. We're not stuck in nature. We're not stuck in this world. We're not even stuck in this universe. And we're not even stuck in consciousness, actually. But without spiritual will, it feels like we are. And then we're frantically negotiating with the ego of how to get free, and the ego says, well, you need a hero. You need a hero. This is what the ego tells us, okay? You need a hero. And so everybody then clamors for a hero. Please, they're praying every day. Pray, please, I need a hero to free me. And all those prayers are heard, but they're for suckers. Because the suckers hear this and say, okay, you need a hero. Okay, I feel so terrible for you. I'm going to come in and try to help you. They get tricked the same way. It's only the great ones, the wise ones, the ones with the wise spiritual will, truly wise spiritual will, that are able to not be tricked by this. And their names are quite famous throughout history, some more so than others. And it's a perplexing thing, because once you go into a coma, you feel like your will is gone, and say, how do I recover it? The key is to begin to accept that we agreed to, quote unquote, give it away. But here's the thing, we can't give our will away. We can't give it away. And then, of course, the ego will say, well, that's why I haven't released the hostages, because you didn't really give it to me. Well, we can't give it to you. It's impossible. So that way it doesn't work. So the way to release the hostages is for each one of us to realize that we can't give our spiritual will away. Just like we cannot kill ourselves. We cannot kill spirit. And once you realize you can't give it away, then you say, well, I can't negotiate with the ego in good faith at all. And so it's useless to negotiate. It's useless. And you just have to tell each one, because each one's trapped the same way. Each one of us has to realize there's nothing that needs to be negotiated, because the Holy Spirit has the vision of oneness for us. And that's all we need to solve our continuity problem. We don't need to get anything from the ego. But when we think we've given it our will, then we think we need to get it back from the ego. We don't need to get it back from the ego, actually. The ego actually doesn't have its talons on our spiritual will. But we think it does. We believe it does. So we feel justified in requesting the release of the hostages. The release of the hostages is not from the ego. It's from our own delusion. It's from our own turning around and realizing that we have a severe continuity problem, and we're afraid to reclaim our will because of this continuity problem. Okay, this is the real problem on this planet, in the universe. Even when we understand that we can't give our will away, and the ego cannot negotiate in good faith, so there is no opportunity to negotiate at all with the ego. And we think, oh my gosh, we'll never free the hostage. No, we're hostage because we think we've given our spiritual will away. Okay, we can get this far. But then everyone kind of says, we're totally stuck, and they start freaking out. No, we don't accept our will, that we cannot give our will away, and we accept this fact, and then we realize our spiritual will is totally intact. We don't do this, because if we did, we would most likely, I don't need any of this stuff. Boom, gone. You know, we just flash out into pure spaciousness as it is, so to speak. I mean, we would just drop the whole ridiculous charade immediately. Oh, I can't give my spiritual away. It's impossible. So there is no such thing as being trapped. So there is no ego. There is no ego entrapping me. We're afraid of this super fast, abrupt transition into a totally different experience than we're used to. That's called the continuity problem. So we don't do it. We keep on imagining the ego's in control of our lives. You see, we want to believe that will can be given away to something else. A projection of our will, and that it becomes something, it's given away. We no longer have it. The projection is somehow separate from us. No, it's not. We can project our will, but we can't give it away. It's still our will entirely. So this is very heavy stuff. Actually, and it should be, because it's really how we awaken from our coma. This feeling of being entrapped, and we paradoxically we are the heroes when we awaken, because we're wise now and we can tell others how they can actually awaken, instead of rescuing them from the ego. No, we help encourage them to work on the continuity problem, so that they can finally feel unafraid to accept that their will is intact and is their will, spiritual will. And we align our expectations and valuing and spiritual will with the vision of oneness, so that when we do wake up from the coma, our spiritual will says, the vision of oneness is what I want. And that gives us this wonderful soft landing, super soft landing of remembrance back to total functioning in reality as it is. So you might remember at some point, maybe it was, seems so long ago, it's hard to remember, where you made this deal. Some make it prior to this life, prior to being born. Some make it early on in their childhood. And some it's just kind of, it just happens almost automatically. You know, there is no spiritual will to, we just feel, oh, we're just trapped. This is just how it is. In my case, I held out through like the year 12 or a long time, and then finally succumbed. So at least I had this awareness that something had gone drastically wrong. That somehow I'd lost my spiritual will. It was amazing. And I became like an idiot. I became like all the other hostages, so-called hostages, really. What the difference is that I said, hey, I didn't used to be like this. Something terrible happened. What happened? Most of the hostages feel like, oh, we've always been this way. We're not hostages, but their spirit is crying out. You see, their spirit at some level is crying out, and they're all pretending, everyone's pretending to be, oh, this is normal, this is natural, because of the continuity problem. They're afraid. They're afraid to say, hey, no. So I tried to give my spiritual will away. That's why I feel the way I feel. I feel like disempowered from a spiritual standpoint. And I'm trying to do everything from a personality, intellectual, energy standpoint, which is, it's not it at all. Absolute. Those are just the tiniest of crumbs is all you get from that. Yeah. And we all act out of fear of the continuity issue. We say to each other, oh, I'll make you happy. If you make me happy, I'll make you happy. Let's make each other happy. We're really terrified. We're saying, I don't want to talk about spiritual will. I don't want to talk about being held hostage. I don't want to talk about all of that. No. Let's just pat each other on the back here and tell ourselves we're happy. The way things are is just fine. We're happy. Everything's good. Don't rock the boat. That's the problem in the world. The fear of the continuity issue is so severe, everybody says here, don't rock the boat. And so when I was young, I rocked the boat. I just said, hey, this is what's going on. And I said, oh, no, you're rocking the boat. You're terrible. You gotta grow up, as everyone said to me. You gotta grow up. You got to grow up. You can't stop acting like a child. You gotta grow up, meaning you've got to become a hostage like the rest of us, and then out of terror of the continuity issue, pretend that everything's fine. So this is the whole situation in the world. Trying to help this world is you run into this buzzsaw of a problem. of a situation is the continuity fear is so severe that no, it's still, I still have it. I can wake up because they're afraid what their will might do when they wake up and realize it's intact. They might just say, hey, I'm out of here. But what I'm suggesting is no. We're not going to do that. We're going to say, we're going to have the vision of oneness, the vision of oneness. Now, by out of here, I don't mean going to another planet or something. I mean out of here, out of perception, time, space, perception, thingness, form, out of that entirely, you know, out of the whole dream, immediately. That's what I mean. Now, we might get out of here by going to some other place because the attempt on the part of the ego, which is really, again, our projection of the severity of the continuity problem that we have. We keep on projecting this ego like we're in it, hostage to it. And the ego then tells us, we project to the ego, says, no, you all got to be happy just the way things are. Let's just work on basic human kindness, basic, you know, do unto one another and get along with your neighbor. And let's just be happy where we are. Let's accept our identity as the body. Let's accept this world as our home. Let's accept this little lifespan as our life. Let's expect some watered down, maudlin spiritual teachings, non-teachings as our teachings. And let's just get along with one another and accept this is it. This is what the ego is after. Basically, it's after keeping all of us in a permanent coma, but it's actually after something else. Because we are trying to uncreate creation so that we can be the new creators of a new creation. And since we are creation, we're really trying to undo ourselves. And we've projected our will, so it seems as though there's this external will to us that is undoing us. And this external will, we've told it it's separate. It's a separate will, free will, separate will. It's doing all this on its own free will, except it's not. So it feels like deep down there's some annihilation principle that could destroy its free will. Its free will is like temporary or something. It's not permanent. And so it wants to get rid of that. It wants to get rid of its maker. It thinks its maker is flawed and didn't make it correctly. See? It's flawed, and so it thinks that the maker spirit is totally flawed, didn't create properly, and needs to be annihilated. And once it's annihilated, out of that annihilation, it'll get rid of the flaw. And somehow the ego will be permanent, new creator. The ego wants to destroy us, in short, it wants to destroy its maker. So, even though it's saying, let's all just get along, smile, be happy, have some good food, and watch television, that's a delaying tactic. It's really figuring out, how can we get everyone into such a state of despair that they decide they're going to commit spiritual suicide? Because the ego can't really kill its maker. It tries, but it can't, so it realizes it has to get us to kill ourselves. So as we're sitting here, I was following this car today. And it's this tech yuppie. I don't know what they call them, a techie maybe. And their zippy little, you know, zippy little car. And they had this decal on the back window. Okay, this is what's going on in this world. This decal was a Tyrannosaurus Rex. And they had this Tyrannosaurus Rex eating people. There were broken bodies on the ground. There was a body in its mouth. There was a body in its claws ready. It was stuffing people into its mouth and eating them. That's the decal on the car. Okay? And nobody says a second thought. Most people probably say, oh, that's cool. And I said, that's absolutely wicked and despicable. And it is. This is the mindset in the world. That's the ego. The ego wants to devour us, actually. And it wants to dispirit us. It wants us to sit in front of our television set and watch dinosaurs eating people. And wants us to, that's what it really wants us to. And then so we'll feel like so little and helpless and hopeless and useless and just food for the dinosaurs that we'll just want to die forever. We'll just feel so dispirited. It wants to dispirit us. I look at that decal, I'm very dispirited by that. That's how the ego works. That's how it rolls. And it, you know, when it came into this, when this phase of self-destructive phase of the ego, remember, if you want us to destroy something, first you build something up that we think is great, and then you tear it apart to bring about despair. That's the ego's game. The ego's game is despair. And to play that game, first you build up something that seems really great, and we think, oh my gosh, look what I have. This is wonderful. Then the ego starts to take it all away from you, and it starts crumbling. And as it crumbles, you go through this horrible despair. I said, oh my God, what's happening to my world? It's like California. You come out to California in the past, and everybody thought it was paradise when they came out here. Absolutely paradise. And they built this whole thing up about this is the place to be on the whole planet. It is the most fabulous place imaginable. They even said that there's gold dust in the air, and that gives you some type of like superhuman immune system and health. And you know, just all this stuff they built up about California, that the plants, the food out here got the gold in it and got some supercharged energy from the sun, the way the sun was. People thought that if you're sick, you come to California, you're going to be cured. Literally, it was the miraculous place in the world. The ego built it all up, and so here we are living here, and one by one, our dream starts just turning into ashes. And now it's just a nightmare. It's just a nightmare. And, you know, having been through two droughts already, I can remember just how devastated I was, because when there's plentiful water, we plant, landscape. And you got these beautiful landscaped homes and lawns, and everything's gorgeous here under this incredible weather. And then the drought comes, and everything's dying and shriveling up, and it just devastates you. It just devastates you. Well, we have the mother of all droughts happening right now. And, I just feel this horrible feeling coming. Yeah. That's the ego, despair. Despair that your pride and joy is suddenly withering and dying in front of your eyes, and you can't do anything to stop it. That's the ego's game. So it has cycles. It has these constructive cycles and destructive cycles in it. But the overall purpose is the destructive cycle. So I would say existence is inherently, fundamentally destructive. It's destructive, designed to produce such despair, that we somehow commit spiritual suicide. Spirit decides it's going to annihilate itself permanently. That's the purpose of existence. People say, I have no idea what existence is. I do. That is the purpose. And so, sure, we have what's called constructive positive cycles. They're always followed by destructive cycles. It's the very nature of how it works. Look at that lovely forest. Oh my God, I'm going to live here and just drink in this incredible bounty of nature. And then 10 years later, oh my God, look, I'm looking out, the whole forest is completely dead. The borer beetles came in, and you know, the fungus got inside and killed everything. And you're just like, you know, just your spirit just feels like it's been, you know, totally gutted. Oh my God, look at this wonderful ocean. We have so bountiful. You're just pulling out these massive fish, just they're everywhere. Now we look at the ocean, it's all acidified. Everything's dying in the ocean, it's all fished out. Look at this beautiful planet. Everyone's like totally psyched up, like, oh my God, this is God's bountiful creation for us. This is the most wonderful thing. You get all this world positive stuff, like, you know, and people say, oh my God, I'm so grateful, Lord, look what you have given me. This incredible, great planet, how wonderful it is. And now look at it, it's dying. We're killing the planet. In a lot of ways, actually. In a lot of ways we don't realize. and whatever side of any, you know, debate people are on, the planet is in big trouble. It's not what it used to be. The whole vibe is different. The total different vibe. on the planet. And I can go on and on and on and on and on. California is the perfect example of it. You know, it just used to be cheap gas, very few cars, wonderful freeways. We just love to drive it. I mean, stop and take pictures everywhere. We're just like we're in heaven. Now, total, you know, gridlock, road rage, just frantic rat race. You can't stop at all. It's just like this. It's just what happened to my baby? What happened to my child? What happened to the love of my life? Really, California was the love of our lives. It really was. We loved this place. Heart and soul, you know, heart and soul. And now it's just like, what happened to our love, you know? And it's grim. It's grim. And this drought, if it keeps going, and it looks like it will. I hope not, but, you know, it's going to freak everybody out. Farmers are going to stop planting their food. You know, this is serious. So this is the ego. This is how it works. Now, once we regain our will and wake up from our coma, it's a whole different story, because we can manifest at that point. We can manifest. We can manifest an entire world if we want to. Easy. We can manifest whatever we want, actually. We can manifest water. We can manifest, you know, food. We can manifest. Absolutely. We no longer are the victims of some external circumstance. We can manifest something that is not part of the egoic dynamic of cycles. We can manifest something that is cycle-free. 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 That is non-composed, that is not suffering from some alignment that can be rearranged. It cannot be rearranged, you see. It's non-composite, non-compounded. It's one. Spiritual will creates as seamless as one totality. So it's not this crazy situation here that we have on this planet. This is all made through a projection, and instead of real true creation, it was kind of the use of spiritual will to get rid of spiritual will. So that's why it seems so bizarre to us, this place, actually. Now I go to the beach, I look at it and say, nah, it's not there. I go to the parks, no, it's not there. Go to the lakes, not go to the mountain, no, it's not there. No, it's not there. It's not anywhere anymore here. And that's the ego's game. Bring about despair. So, right now, there's a division in the world about how things are going. Some people think things are going absolutely fantastic. This great bull market is enriching people, you know, and we feel that there's a great recovery happening. We've got these brilliant leaders that are leading us into a golden age, that life, there's so many things, so many opportunities, that things are going to be great. That's the personality. And then there are those who, from the spiritual standpoint, say, no, things are going terrible, because we're falling into this cult of personality, and we're to believe that's all there is, that all we are is the personality. So we're trapped in personal will instead of spiritual will. Okay? What the ego wants to do is trap us in personal will instead of spiritual will. And that's why you see this cult of personality, this cult personality factory of Hollywood, which is really all over the world now. Movie making, image making, television making, show making, music making, entertainment making, personality making, politician making, you know, society making, civilization making. It's a cult of personality designed to get us to believe that personal will is all there is. This is the insidious situation of these days. So I would say things are getting, we're at a total crisis. We're in a world war, actually. A war of wills, where the ego is saying, no, your will is only a personal will. That's the only will you have, is personal will. You don't have any other will. And we're saying, no, we have spiritual will. And we just tried to give it away, but we can't give it away. So there's nothing else for us to do but to accept that we can't give it away and we have it. There isn't any other option. Really, there isn't any other option. It's just a matter of how long it takes for us to realize this, but there is no other option except to recognize and accept we can't give it away. We can't give it away. We can't give our life away. Spirit cannot give itself away. It's impossible. There's nothing to give it away to. For one thing, in order to give something away, you have to have something to give it away to. How can every awareness give itself away? To what? To where? So, this is the war that's taking place, and it's all out. The lines have been crossed. I think this Malaysian plane disappearance was actually some sort of a psychop at some level to bring despair to people, because it's really very despairing, actually. Very despairing for people just to vanish and nobody knows what happened. It's so despairing. We think we're in control. We want to be in control. And we feel like, oh, I can't control. Wow, I'm helpless. When every time I get in a plane, we're thinking, oh my God, I have no will. The pilot's will could just take me out in the ocean and we'll just be in the bottom of the sea. And it's a very dispiriting feeling, actually. And I've been feeling it. Actually, I've been looking at the situation. I say, what is going on here? It's a psychop, a psych-out operation. Fundamentally, actually, at some level. Superficially, at the personality level, who knows exactly, but at a deeper level, it is a way to dispirit the world. The ego is, I said, the war is to dispirit us, okay? Have us sit, watch dinosaurs eating people, reptiles, huge reptiles eating people, and people shooting people, and all these sobbing victims about being victimized, and court dramas about victimization and violence and all this stuff, and this dispirits us. And we say, oh my God, we really are just these beasts. We really are just these bodies, these beasts. And then the news comes on, and the plane is missing. People just vanishing. And they say, oh, they're at the bottom of the ocean. How horrible. People think, oh my God, how horrible. And this is how the ego wants us to spend our time. This is how the ego wants us to spend our time, like this. So we get dispirited. So we feel there is no spiritual will. Because when we look at all this kind of stuff, we say, wait a minute, how can there be any spiritual will? If there was, none of this would be happening. Right? So the ego, it's easy for the ego to say, hey, spiritual will is a myth. It's really personality will. And it's the survival of the fittest and the struggle, all this stuff. And so it's this massive con job that the ego is engaged in. And this is the war. It's the war, it is a war. It is a war. It's a war of will. It's a war of will. And the ego is very vicious at this, and there's lots of ways that it pursues this. So, what we're doing here is we're gathering our will. And to do that, we don't really relate at the personality level. So this is something that my whole life I refuse to relate to people at the personality level, basically. So, I seem standoffish at the personality level, but if someone wants to engage me at the level of spirit, then I'm very engaged with that. So you hear a plane overhead and you say, I wonder where that's going. Are the people going to be, is it going to be diverted? Because we don't know what happened. How is it diverted? We don't, why? What's going, can we trust the planes? It's just a very, that's why these people who divert planes and causes a despair in the world. It really does. It's not a good thing. It's not a good thing. The bomb blowing up. No, it's designed to bring about despair and being dispirited. You know, it targets certain races, certain civilizations, certain countries. So, you know, it tries to bring about despair in the population. And it is quite effective in a lot of ways, actually. But it brings about a global despair that the ego uses will, you know. There, that's the one. They have your will. You know, kill them, you'll recover it for yourself. They're possessing it. And so easy for the ego to foment wars. Easy. Projection. Just say they're the ones. That's why you don't have your spirit. That's why you feel you're lacking in will, because they have it. So if you just, and they tell the ego tells the other one the same thing, that you feel lacking in will because they have it. Easy conflict. See, easy conflict. So how do we gather our will? We have to practice at the level of spiritual will. We have to practice. We can have a little bit of spiritual will, even though we think we've given it away. We can feel like, well, I didn't give it all away. I didn't give it entirely away. I still have a memory of it, or I'm starting to get it back. I'm starting to get it back. We can function from that level. I'm starting to get it back. And then actually practice at that level. All right, seems like someone is arriving home. I will be right back, and we will work on reviving, coming out of our coma, and remembering our spiritual will, okay? Now, first of all, we need to say, I am not a hostage to anything that I see. I am not a hostage to anything that I see. I am not a hostage to this tree. I am not a hostage to this sunset. I am not a hostage to this place. I am not a hostage to this wall. I am not a hostage to this air. I'm not a hostage to this body. I'm not a hostage to this world. I'm not a hostage to this universe. I am not a hostage to anything I see. I am not a hostage. This powerful, powerful to wake us up out of our coma. It helps us soft awakening from our coma. I am not a hostage to anything that I see. The power of decision is within me. I am not a hostage to anything I see. The power of decision is within me. I cannot give my will away. I cannot give myself away. I cannot give myself away. The power of decision resides within me forever and forever. I am not a hostage to anything that I see. I am not a hostage to anything that I see. So, we can feel, how does that feel? I am not a hostage to anything that I see. I am not a hostage to this walkway. I'm not a hostage to this moment. I'm not a hostage to this day. I am not a hostage to this day. So we're working on it directly right here, more directly than I expected, but this is good. I am not a hostage to that wall. I am not a hostage to this telephone. I am not a hostage to the news. I am not a hostage to the television set. I'm not a hostage to the newspaper. I'm not a hostage to the computer. I'm not a hostage to the automobile. I'm not a hostage to this street. I'm not a hostage to this house. I'm not a hostage to this room. I am not a hostage to this room. I am not a hostage to this city. I'm not a hostage to this country. I'm not a hostage to this planet. I'm not a hostage to this galaxy. I'm not a hostage to this universe. I'm not a hostage to the multiverse. The power decision is within me. I cannot give myself away. I cannot give my will away. I am not a hostage to anything that I see. The power of decision is within me. Okay, so we are gathering our will like this. Now, let us practice. When we wake up, what is it that we're going to see? When we come out of our coma, what is it that we're going to see? We are going to see the uncomposed, unarranged, non-related, non-localized, process-free, non-fabricated singularity of inseparable, transparent, zero density, traceless, baseless, effulgent, never ceasing, totally smoothed out smoothness of the great peace of peace, the great bliss of bliss, the great vision of vision, the great freedom of freedom. And so what we can practice is two steps in awakening from the coma is gather our will, gather our will. I am not a hostage to anything that I see. And then focus on, well, how does it feel to not be a hostage to anything? What is it that we see? What I see is hostage free. I am hostage free is what I see. We see the smoothed out stillness of stillness, the groundless stillness of stillness, the undefined stillness of stillness, undefined. We enter into this pristine state, this ever freshness of the pristine pristineness, of the calm calmness, of the lovely loveliness, of the eternal eternalness, of the timeless timelessness, of the calm calmness, of the serene sereneness, of the immutable immutableness, of the formless formlessness, of the blissful blissfulness, of the peaceful peacefulness, of the graceful gracefulness. We enter into that. Want to scare the neighbors to say, what are you talking about, the unborn, non-crystallizing, spaced out silence of silenceness? Well, it sounds pretty good to me. The natural, total core of ultimate peacefulness beyond peacefulness. What did I say? The peaceful peacefulness of ultimate peaceful peacefulness. Okay. The infallible, immutable, and ultimate now. We can't say nowful, can we? Beautiful, beautiful, beautifulness. The beautiful, beautifulness. We get to the nowfulness. You can't really quite say that. The clarity of clarityness. The immutable immutableness. The eternal eternity. So I'm just looking to say, okay, so anyway, it's a work in progress, which is part of awakening from the coma. At least we feel like, hey, I'm not going to just awake this instant if we struggle a little bit. Freedom of freedomness, the now of nowness, we can say that. The peace of peacefulness, or the peaceful peacefulness. The clarity of clarity-ness. I don't know how you say that. The smooth smoothfulness, a very smooth smoothfulness, the clear clarity, the clear clarity, the clear clarity, the intrinsic, all good, supreme, clear clarity. Okay. So what are we going to see? More importantly, what are the two steps? One, gather our will. I am not a hostage of anything that I see. Two, how are we going to see the hostage-free condition? And it is this non-crystallizing, wide open, spaced out purity of purity. The pureness of purity. The pureness of purity. The fresh freshness of pure purity. The fresh freshness of pure purity. The fresh freshness of pure purity. That's how we're going to feel. That's how what we're going to experience. The fresh freshness of pure purity. And we say, oh yeah, this is the fresh freshness of pure purity. Yeah. That's what it is. Okay, I get it. That's what I'm experiencing, this fresh freshness of pure purity. This ultimate, non-compounded, non-composed, non-arranged, non-fabricated singularity, one without another, as it isness, this fresh freshness of pure purity, this fresh freshness, the smoothed out smoothness of the fresh freshness of the pure purity, as we could say it that way too. The serene serenity of the smooth smoothness of the fresh freshness. Of the still stillness. Of the lovely loveliness of the pure, pure, pure purity. I think that one rang my bell for sure. What are we going to experience? I am not a hostage to anything that I see. The power of decision is within me. I am not a hostage of that tree. I am not a hostage of this light. I am not a hostage of this bottle. I am not a hostage of this world. I am not a hostage of this dust. I am not a hostage of this dirt. I am not a hostage of that rock. I am not a hostage of this air. I am not a hostage of that lake. I am not a hostage of that ocean. I am not a hostage of this plane. I am not a hostage of this car. I am not a hostage of anything that I see. I am not a hostage of anything that I see. The power of decision is within me. The power of decision is within me. And what do I experience? I experience the peaceful peacefulness of the blissful blissfulness of the one oneness of the glory, glorified glory, of the glorious glory, of the serene serenity, of the calm calmness, of the grateful gratefulness, of the smooth smoothness, of the clear clarity, of the fresh freshness, of the graceful grace, of the holy holiness, of the lovely loveliness, of the lovely loveliness, of the pure, 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 pure purity. Pure purity of the silent silence, of the spacious spaciousness, of the word-free wordlessness, of the lighted light, of the divine divinity, of the effortless effortlessness, of the seamless seamlessness, of the boundless boundlessness, of the centered centeredness, of the assured assurance, of the carefree carefreeness, of the beauty of beautiful beautifulness, of the everywhere of everywhereness, of the now of nowness, of the eternity of the eternal, of the timeless of the timelessness, of the formless of the formlessness, of the sweet, 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 of the sweetness, of the sweet, 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 of the sweetness, of the ageless of the agelessness, of the endless of the endlessness, of the is of the isness, the is of the isness, of the simplicity of simpleness, of the being of beingness, of the core of coreness, of the changeless of the changelessness, of the aware of awareness, the awareness of awareness, awareness, of the miracle of the miraculousness, of the surety of sureness, of the source of the sourceness, of the instant of the instantness, the such of the suchness, the that of the thatness, the inherent, unchanging, traceless, intrinsic empowerment of the pure, 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 pureness. So we're just working here, not with perfect effectiveness, because if we had perfect effectiveness, we would really come out of our coma just like that. So it's okay when you're having your practicing that it doesn't have to be spot on all the time. That's okay. You're looking for something. So you're gathering your will. The effulgent peace of peacefulness. The immutable bliss of blissfulness, the traceless love of loveliness, the traceless love of loveliness, the traceless love of loveliness that is neither inside nor outside, the transparent still. Is that a still? The transparent still of stillness. It doesn't quite come out. The transparent purity of the space of spaciousness. Okay? The transparent purity of the space of spaciousness is the authentic glory of the mindless divinity, the inherent glory of the mindless divinity, of the mindless divinity of the divine. Okay, the mindless divinity of the divine. The unceasing, non-crystallizing seamlessness of the seamless. See, the non-crystallizing, unbinding seamlessness of the seamless. Okay. The all-pervasive, supreme non-localized timelessness of the timeless. That is what I'm seeing. I am seeing the unceasing, non-crystallizing supreme. Okay, so we are, see, we are making progress, because keep in mind, we're waking up from a coma. So we're a little fuzzy, right? Of course. That's perfectly fine. The ego tries to bait us by saying, hey, how come you're not doing it perfectly? How come you're not doing it flawlessly? What's the matter? There must be something flawed. You must be flawed. Oh, you don't want to wake up to your flawed self. And the ego says, oh, look, you're waking up to your flawed self. You see how flawed it is? And we say, no, ego. We're waking up from our coma of trying to give our will away from you. And so we have this continuity fear. So that's making us clumsy. See, we have to turn that around. If we don't put it on the basis that we have a continuity problem, so we're clumsy and we're fuzzy because of that, and also because we don't want to wake up too fast, the ego will turn it around, turn the tables on us and say that what we're waking up to is flawed. That's why we're having these flaws. And then we'll go back into our coma. And that's why people don't make progress on the spiritual path. Everybody can give it a go. You know, hey, step right up and give it a go. Win a stuffed animal, you know. And then, I'm scared. I got too scared. I stopped. That's the history of everyone's life. I got too scared. I stopped. Here, we don't stop because we say, no, I have a super severe continuity problem. So for sure, I'm going to stumble and fumble and bumble. As I'm rumbling to the end zone, I'm going to stumble and fumble and bumble and fumble. And I've got to get the pigskin back and say, okay, you know, the football. Recover the fumble, get back up, and try another play. That's how it goes. That's how it goes. So, it's I actually feel it's better to do it this way, live like this, where there are these stumbling. So you actually get reassured by that. There's something very intimidating about a book, and it's set there, and it seems so perfect, and it's very dispiriting. I got to tell you, that's honestly, no matter how great the book is, for instance, A Course in Miracles, it still seems intimidating. Because it seems so perfect and so certain, and I'm sitting there and I stumble, I fumble, I forget, and I just feel like, wow, maybe I'm just no good at this. So, yeah, I feel that this kind of live sharing here, practicing, gathering our will, practice of gathering our will and coming out of our coma, dealing with the continuity problem directly like this, is more helpful, because you see. This is how you struggle. It's inevitable. And it's okay. It's absolutely okay. Whereas the book, you feel like, God, I'm just come up so short of that, you know, perfection. It's set. It's crystallized. Set in stone. Here, it's spontaneous. It's organic. We're doing it live. We're doing it right now. And so, I think it's terrific, which is why I keep doing it. What are we seeing? We're seeing the authentic. When we gather our will, what do we see? The authentic. The infallible. The ultimate. The total now. The total now of nowness. The total now of nowness is what we're seeing. We are seeing the groundless, baseless, unborn, unceasing loveliness of love. The loveliness of love. We are seeing the all good, immutable, residue free smoothness. Residue free smoothness of the smooth. We are seeing the spaced out, non-fixated, immaculate grace, the immaculate grace of gracefulness, or the immaculate gracefulness of grace. I think we'd say it this way. We are seeing the natural, spaced out, non-crystallizing gracefulness of grace. That plant as it is the natural, spaced out, non-crystallizing gracefulness of grace. It is the spaced out, authentic, non-crystallizing, smooth gracefulness of grace. That table as it is the ultimate, the total, effulgent and non-concretized, spaced out and authentic gracefulness of grace. It is this day as it is, this day as it is the real, all good, immaculate, wide open, pure center of centeredness. It is the pure center of centeredness. This day as it is the pure center of centeredness. It is the fresh, inseparable, transparent, ultimate, non-fabricated, uncompounded, effulgent, and unborn stillness, silence of stillness. It is the silence, the pure silence of stillness. It is the silence of the silent. It is the silence of the silent. It is the silence of the traceless. It is the silence of the intrinsic, natural, spaced out, all good. I am seeing the timeless timelessness of the forgiving forgiveness of the one oneness. The blissful blissfulness of the peaceful peacefulness of the free freedom. I am seeing the abstract of abstraction. I'm seeing the very abstract, the total abstract. I'm seeing the total abstraction of the abstract. I'm seeing the total seeing of the seeing. I'm seeing the simplicity of the simple. I'm seeing the simplicity of the simple. And then practicing specifics with whatever's around you. That table as it is the authenticity of the authentic, is the authenticity of the authentic. It is the greatness of the great perfection. It is the simplicity of the simple. It is the peace. It is the peacefulness of peace. This table as it is the peacefulness of peace. This day as it is the peacefulness of peace. This moment as it is the peacefulness of peace. The purity, the pureness of purity, the loveliness of love. This world as it is the loveliness of love. It is the inside free, outside free, instant of the instantaneous. It is the instant of the instantaneous. This moment as it is the instant of the instantaneous. It is the nowness of now. That dirt is the nowness of now. That flower is the nowness of now. That flower as it is the inside free, outside free, nowness of now. It is the, that dirt as it is the baseless and traceless, inside, outside free, nowness of now. The base free, the baseless nowness of now. That dirt is the baseless nowness of now. So, it is the wide open, unelaborated, uncomposed, unaligned, totally non-aligned wide open pure spaciousness of pure spaciousness, the totally non-aligned that plant is the totally non-aligned pure spaciousness, pure space of spacious, pure spaciousness. That plant as it is the totally non-aligned pure space of pure spaciousness. So that plant as it is the pure glorious, the pure glorious groundlessness, the pure glorious rootless groundlessness of the groundless, the rootless groundlessness of the groundless. This table as it is the pure is the effulgent glory of the rootless groundlessness of the groundless. That tree as it is the radiant glory of the pure groundlessness of the groundless. So all we're doing is we are practicing getting ready to actually see what we see when we realize that our will is still our own. That's it. That's what we'll see. We'll see this vision of oneness, we call it, just for shorthand, physical vision of oneness. It's the unalloyed and transparent wide openness. The unalloyed, the transparent wide openness. The transparent wide openness. This plant as it is the transparent wide openness. This room as it is the transparent wide openness. This everythingness as it is the transparent wide openness. The transparent wide openness as it is. Inside free, outside free, free of free, is the one freedom, is the one isness that is it rests upon, it is the great perfection rests upon the great perfection. The peace rests upon peace. The self sprung blissfulness of bliss rests, subsides into the self-sprung blissfulness of bliss. The formless being of being, the formless self-sprung being of being, is spontaneously self-released into the self-sprung being of being. The pure awake mind of this plant as it is self-released as the pure awake mind of this plant as it is. The pure awake mind of this moment, the pure awake mind of this self-sprung moment as it is self-released as pure subsidence in the this awake moment as it is. So sometimes these practices, you can feel they really have a tremendous resonance to them. And it's hard to say which one will. I don't really know. I don't really know ahead of time. I just sometimes suddenly, wow, you know, just feel like this is really feeling just very potent. And you just have to, you don't know ahead of time what's going to do it. You really don't. There isn't necessarily anyone in particular, and next day it might be different. Because the ego is always trying to, you know, block. The great perfection of this timeless moment, self-sprung as the zero density-free, clear transparency of the vision of freedom is as it is, self-released into the immaculate subsidence, into the peaceful, blissful oneness of the all-good source of traceless, residue-free clarity, light, and divinity. Clarity, light, and divinity. Clarity, light, and divinity. Subsides into the self-released as pure subsidence into the clarity, light, and divinity. The all goodness of clarity, light, and divinity. Clarity, light, and divinity. Subsides, pure subsidence. Pure, effortless, formless subsidence. Self-released as pure, effortless subsidence into the core centeredness of pure light divinity, pure light divinity, pure light love, pure light bliss, clear presence of bliss, pure presence of eternity.